Okay, we're ready to go. So today's episode of the Scholar Gypsies, I'm very delighted to have Dara O'Flaherty. He's a Galway man here. He's an activist. He's what I kind of call a citizen journalist and a community educator. Many of you will be very, very familiar with Dara. And I'm very interested, I'm very interested in having more people that are really active on the ground on various issues. So there's a number of issues I want to talk to Dara today about. But I suppose the first one, we'll start at the end. There earlier in the week, yourself and Dave O'Reilly were in court in Galway. And from what I could gather, you're in court for taking picture or a video of an empty hospital, and that seems to be a criminal offence now. So maybe we could start there.
Well, the real offence was contradicting the narrative. The mm-hmm. narrative was in all of the newspapers over the course of a number of weeks that our hospitals were on the brink, our hospitals were being pushed to their limits, our hospitals were bowing down to the COVID. And we knew the opposite to be true, but also we knew that this idea of the hospitals being under pressure was being used to put pressure on the public to get involved with the vaccine narrative, that this was a way out of all of the stress and panic that we were seeing in our health system. And it was emotional blackmail to induce a sense of fear and dread of the outcomes without the vaccine that the hospitals mm-hmm. would collapse. And this was what the point I managed to raise while defending myself on Tuesday, I think. It was that, you know, there was a million people diagnosed extra with cancer this year in Europe. There's a million people extra with heart disease this year in Europe. And around the time that myself and David O'Reilly went into the hospital in Galway, was around the time that the people started dying in the care homes in January. You know, it was exactly the time back. And here we were looking at a NUIG hospital, which we both regarded as a sacred place. You know, this is a place where Galway people come to be born, and be ill, and have dramatic episodes in their life, and even die. And we've both seen many, like I've said, prayers on many floors of that hospital for very ill. And it was a sacred place to us, as it is to many people from Galway. And the shocking thing was how inactive it was. It was so, like, I could see from one end of the casualty department to the other, and there was two doctors halfway down looking in a computer, and the entire casualty department, I'd say it's, if it's not 100 meters, certainly 80 meters, was void of people. There was nobody left or right. And that was scary to us. You know? That there was many people who weren't attending hospital for all kinds of ailments while the hospital wasn't being run. And we had information from inside the hospital that the hospital was running at a lower capacity. And we had information from patients who were being forced to wait outside the hospital for treatment in a porta cabin with no heat in their dressing gowns, thus to prevent the spread of the disease, which apparently was already in the hospital. You know, like, why would you try to stop a cancer patient who might have COVID coming into a hospital that definitely does have COVID? You know, how much more COVID can he give the hospital? It just didn't, you know, I had very close friends who were very, very ill and made to wait in cold, damp conditions in a prefab out the front, like cattle out the front door. It felt that bad. So we had to make some record of the under capacity. And it was obvious to anybody to see because there was no cars in the car park, front or back. Even in the multi-story car park at the back, they were empty. So who was looking after the sick people if they didn't come in their car, like, you know? So there was basic thing. And like, we saw four ward closed signs. So there were signs outside various wards which was entirely closed and the lights were off. You know, so how can you say a hospital with four wards, four out of eight possible wards are closed. 50% capacity is closed, and you're saying that it's on the brink. We had also information from a whistleblower for a pharmaceutical company, which actually made it to the paper, the Irish Times. Now, the information was illegally got, and it was more a breach of GDPR, but that didn't mean that it wasn't true. And this man worked for a company that distributed pharmaceuticals in A&E, and they use a robot. So they program your name into this robot, and it the robot knows how many what drugs you're supposed to get. They fill up all the different slots on the, like a cigarette machine, I suppose. They fill up all the slots and they go around and say, I'm at Dara O'Flaherty's bed. And the robot spits out a cup with a load of tablets in it and you take it, and that's how, so there's no mistakes. But this man who worked for that company that made that robot, he took the data using his manager's password, and he was able to show that the pharmaceuticals that were being delivered in Irish emergency departments around the country during that lockdown period were less than 10% of what was typically administered in a previous year. And of course, that man was crushed like a butterfly under a cat's paw as well, you know? So every time we encountered anybody who could emphatically prove that the narrative that was being peddled in the media was certainly questionable, at least, and definitely deserved the other side of the debate to be heard. You know, they were crushed. And the scary thing about it that I didn't realize until immediately prior to the court case, Jerry, was that these people who done this to me and David and other people who were treated in the same way and indeed continue to be treated the same way, is that they believed the momentum was such that the steamrolling would continue and that we would actually just be ground into the ground and they would continue on with their totalitarian narrative. You know, we were that close. You know, if we hadn't been able to arrest that, and it wasn't through our fault, the virus mutated and got weaker. Remember that. We didn't, no one saved us. The virus got weaker and people stopped dying.
Well, that's 100%, because we're right. We're probably at the anniversary point of the height of the madness last year, where it was, you know, everybody was being made to feel that they were, you know, that they were, there was something wrong with them, you know, and we had to be, you know, there was a number of people on television promoting that, you know, we should be kind of half expelled from society altogether. Not that we weren't already. And what you're saying about the empty hospitals and the time period, I spoke to a consultant that was responsible for managing the COVID response in a hospital in Dublin. And he said to me, he was embarrassed by the fact that his hospital was empty when everybody was coming up, shaking hands to him and, you know, well done. And, you know, this kind of, especially into 20, he said there was two periods, one in, you know, the very beginning, and then one a period of about 2 weeks in January of 21, when things did, January 21, there were, you know, things were a lot busier. But he says, other than that, it tallies very well with what you're saying to me there. I suppose I wanted to ask you, how did it get from, okay, you yourself and Dave or whoever, we'll say whatever happened there, how did the authorities come into contact with you on the video? Was it posted, or how did you come into the court system, is what I suppose the question.
Well, it was actually, we encountered authorities on the night. So we went into the hospital and we initially found a corridor that was stacked with beds. I mean, the beds were on top of the beds, on one side of the wall. And then it was like palm trees or pineapple trees with all these kind of devices, you know, these that they hang the bags of fluid off or the kidney. And it was like, it was hard to describe. It was like a porcupine's back looking down this corridor. Beds on one side stacked three or four on top of each other. And this field of equipment. You would have had to take every piece of equipment as you're going down. There was no way to access this corridor. It was totally jammed. And I was appalled. So I immediately began to record. And I went upstairs and I realized, hang on, actually, this whole wing of the hospital, it would have been the old wing that was perpendicular to the casualty ward. I think it would have been the ear, nose, and throat clinic back in the day, maybe, or something.
Oh,
like
I
that.
Know it. Yeah.
Yes. So we came in the old smoking door, if you know, out the back door of the hospital. And immediately we encountered this storage of equipment. So immediately I began to recover. And I realized, actually, as I went upstairs, that, you know, there's very little going on here. This is the storage wing. So I went down and took a right, went back over to the old hospital where the lifts are, the big lifts. And I guess we went floor to floor and just looked into the corridor of each ward with the camera. And it was empty. I mean, there was nobody. No, I accept there was probably people in some of the rooms, or even a lot of the rooms. But there was no activity. Do you know what I mean? There was nobody around doing anything. You know, it was empty, you know. But at the same time, you know, what was considered full capacity before was very, very busy. And to see the casualty department completely empty, the casualty waiting room completely empty, no one in X-ray, no one at all in X-ray, either X-ray. You know, no one in the corridor, no one having a cigarette. There's no activity at all. And then you saw four different ward signs closed, you know. And I guess the security guard at some point had realized that there's somebody going around with a camera. And that would have been very counter-narrative. Very, very counter-narrative to, you know, the front line, give them a bull of bus and, you know, this kind of, you know. So we exited the building and they had called the police. And by the time we got up the mortuary road and heading towards our vehicle, the police had caught up with us. And they didn't want to listen to us at all. They only wanted to hear what the security guard had to say. And we, like, even the crime that they charged us with, the Garda couldn't actually shouldn't have used that act of law unless he encountered us on the premises.
Mm-hmm.
A public order trespass charge. The Garda is actually supposed to meet you on the premises and say to you, you know, you're not supposed to be here, leave. And if you refuse to leave, then he's supposed to arrest you for a public order trespass. So actually, these Gardaí who arrested us should have given us a warning that we were trespassing and given us an opportunity to leave. Because, you know, you might trespass accidentally onto a place. You know, you might realize you're in trespassing. So public order can be quite inoffensive when used correctly. You know, you say, look, this isn't where you're not supposed to be here. If you don't go, I'm going to have to arrest you. It's pretty straightforward, isn't it? You know, so he used that kind of a law and they do it all the time. What they done then, I guess, it was late in the evening, so by the time the morning had come around, Dublin was aware that David O'Reilly and Dara O'Flaherty had been arrested due to that. You know, the whole narrative was spilling out, like, you know.
Did that make the national press, Dara? Did it?
Oh, did, yeah. And you see, they had a National Garda unit by us as well, who were supposed to be digging up dirt on us, you know. And
so that's a case of them leaking. Like, that can only happen if the guards actively leak the information to the media. Like.
Yes, exactly, yeah. So the idea was, you see, to tarnish us, to paint us as subhuman, the kind of people who would go into a person's sick bed in a hospital and paint. I would put that, if I came in front of it, I would put me in jail for doing that. I would put anybody in jail for doing that. The likelihood is, and I never got to say to a guard, if I had encountered somebody in someone's hospital bedroom filming them, I would have picked up some kind of charge. I would have had to drag them out by their collar out of the room filming. To be associated with that kind of behavior is just so far from who I am. And to allow that to be on the wire in the public domain for two full years, they could not have held out any longer without prejudice in their case. They were now heading for what the Europeans described as excessive length of proceeding. And when the European courts challenged the Irish government on their continuous excessive length of proceeding, except all the time, they're always 2, 3, 4 years in order to clean up their act and fly right and fly straight. The Irish government response was, we won't fix the problem. Instead, what we'll do is we'll compensate. After 2 years, we'll give you compensation for your... So they didn't shorten the length of proceedings. They just bribe defendants. They just hand them some cash and say, "Shut up, you. We're gonna prosecute you," you know, eventually. But they'll actually pay off to sit there quietly waiting to be prosecuted.
Yeah. Oh, like the whole district. It was the district court you were in as well, was it?
Yes, the district court.
Yeah, like the district, across the board, the district court, like every type of offence is dragged out to the nth degree. But I suppose what I wanted to ask is, how did the Gardaí approach it on Tuesday? Because obviously they made a claim that was false. And did they just hold up their hands and say, "Look, sorry"? Or how did that work out?
Yeah, you know, it's, you see, what we see as points within the process, you know, different kind of fiducials throughout the process. We say the summons period, the disclosure period, the maybe bail hearings, all these different aspects of a hearing. The Gardaí are so many generations at it, and the court staff are so many generations at it, that when they encounter a suspect or a defendant that has particular interest, that we say, they are more than capable and more than knowledgeable about how to direct the trajectory of the case through the system to cause as much pain as possible. Okay? So they know how to make paperwork not appear and disappear, but how to cause as much psychological, they're disturbing your sleep. Like, you don't sleep for a week before a court case. Well, I do anymore. You know, I'm used to it. But a lot of people, it's a kind of a psychological war, and it's extrajudicial punishment. You're up and down for these mentions all the time. You know, if you have a lawyer, the lawyer is getting paid. The Gardaí, you're getting paid to be there. Everybody's getting paid except the defendant. And that was actually something I had the great pleasure to point out to the judge on Tuesday there last. I opened with a pretrial matter and I said, "Your Honor, I appear before you today with the liability of fine or imprisonment. And I ask you now, if this case turns out to be based on false allegations, who on the side of the prosecution is liable to similar curtailment, be it fine or imprisonment, as I am here?" And he took a moment before he answered me, but he did answer me.
What did he say?
He said the DPP. Yeah. So
very
that's,
good.
That's
it looked. So it was, I suppose, it was a win basically, and that. It looked to me like, was that David's first time? I saw a video you did beforehand and I could see, I just taught myself, I says, it looked to me like it was David's first time in front, you know, in a court situation. Whereas I could tell it wasn't you, like you had, you could tell you knew, or maybe I'm wrong about this, but I could tell you knew the processes and you were much more, I won't say relaxed, but you were confident about what kind of was going to happen.
Yeah, absolutely. I think David has engaged the court process as a friend of the courts, we'll say, maybe as a witness or someone who could. But as a defendant, no. David had never been in court as a defendant.
No, because for anyone that's in it, like it's a harrowing, you know, the pageantry of the state and all this kind of stuff. The first time you go into it. I suppose that brings me kind of on to a semi, you know, we're in the pandemic era at the moment in our conversation. And I suppose you and another figure that many of people in Ireland will be aware of is Andy Heisman, and the activism that you're doing on the ground. I'm particularly aware of the vaccination centre in Carrick and Shannon, and I think also you've been in to serve papers to the Garda Síochána in Carrick and Shannon. Maybe you could just give us a bit of background on that whole, how you're going about all of that stuff.
Well, you know, I'm a man of very few resources, so the solutions I come up with always fit inside that framework. That you know, it's not resource based. I'm not going to have a bunch of barristers and lawyers and da da da. You know, it's going to be probably handwritten at some point, and then I'll typed up. And, you know, it's going to be a pretty straightforward, simple thing. Because I'm a national living in my nation, and I've got duties to protect other nationals living in my nation. You know, I have duties that go way beyond that, of course, but those are basic duties that I have. So if I saw someone stealing your bicycle, you know, either I try to stop them stealing your bicycle, or I go and I tell the guard I saw this man stealing your bicycle. You know, so when I see crime, I'm obliged to act, and I have seen a lot of crime in the last couple of years, and the process of complaining is quite, you know, it's designed in a way to stop frivolous complaints, because frivolous complaints are really, you know, counterproductive. So you have to be a serious complainant, first of all. You have to really believe what you've said, and you really have to have studied it and debated it, and, you know, you have to have confidence. Because when you approach a Garda, he's assessing your ability to carry this complaint through a court case and get a verdict. And unless he has the confidence that you can do that, he knows he's wasting his time. Now, maybe he'll recover your bicycle for you. Or maybe he'll recover some, you know, he's useful in that situation. But when you're trying to win an argument, you really need to have the Garda's confidence, you know, as opposed to recovering property or something like that. So, you know, their time is very limited, and their lives have become much more full of pressure and work. You know, it's very busy for Garda. So, but I would, my case is that if everybody complained, not repeat my complaint, but complained in why they think the Pfizer vaccine trial was a problem, or why they think that not getting consent for a vaccine trial is fraud or inconsistent with some law. You know, there's so much behavior. I was outside the Dáil giving out to some guard. Now, it was justifiable. He was behaving horribly, and it was escalating. And I guess the inspector on the scene at the Dáil Éireann, he came out to resolve the situation. No, he was a superintendent, actually. His inspector came out, and then a superintendent came out. And the superintendent, at one point in the conversation, said, Dara, nobody ever comes to us and complains about these things. Nobody ever walks into a Garda station and says, this is a problem, or that's a problem, or this is another problem. And he really, he got me there, you know, because I knew he was right. You know?
And so in a sense... In a sense, is what you're saying is they don't know how to deal with the, like, is there a bit of that in what's going on in terms of, like, what's your sense of that situation? Is it a sense of they're kind of don't know how to deal with the situation because, like, that superintendent says, nobody ever does it, even though it's perfectly within their rights to do it.
Yeah, but you see, how can you expect an agent of the state to go against the narrative without having something concrete like a piece of paper in his hand? You know, you can't expect it. Of course, you have every right to expect a Garda would live up to his duty and do what's right. But they're human beings, and they have mortgages to pay. They have kids in school who are used to a certain lifestyle. And the moment they say, this vaccine is not good for people, they're going to be moved to an island off the coast of Donegal, you know? You know, that's what happens. You know, I said it to the judge recently, that judge again, he said, oh, where are the, I said, I had represented people who from the hospital who told us that the hospitals were empty. Oh, where are these people? Well, I said, I couldn't involve them in this court case without protective disclosures, you know, that there'd be a whistleblower. And sure, when was a whistleblower ever treated with anything but absolute contempt in Ireland? You know?
Especially, well, that's how you know if it's a true whistleblower, because the reaction of the state is normally negative, like hugely negative.
Hugely, overwhelmingly, you know. They throw a pile of money at crucifying the person. You know? So how can we then, if we don't even demand accountability, whistleblower case, demand that a Garda will stand up and risk everything on basis of what? You know, you have to give him something very cogent and solid. He has to be able to follow a path that he can withstand whatever criticism he gets from his superiors, whatever pressure they get from their superiors. This Garda has to be able to hold his ground, you know, And that's not easy to do. But you know what actually helps them way more than the precision of the complaint is the numbers of complaints.
Yeah.
If there was 1,000 numbers and then 10,000 numbers of messy complaints, they have to do something. They have to.
What would you say the base, what's your opinion that the base standard of kind of evidence that somebody should bring with them to a Garda station in, you know, in the, without repeating what you've done, but what would, like, if somebody was so inclined to do what you're saying, what would you say would be the base, you know, the minimum they'd need to kind of gather it, what type of information would they want to be bringing with them?
Well, you know, from an evidentiary point of view, you can't beat expert testimony. It's unassailable, you know. And one of the major battles we're fighting is that the narrative is running on drug company data and drug company statements. And we're running on expert testimony. We're running on professional doctors, epidemiologists, and virologists, whereas NAMA was running on data and statements from Pfizer, Moderna, and such and such, like the head of Neffet. The head of Neffet was a physiotherapist. You know, it's not, that's not by accident. We can't later claim then that Neffet were expertly doing the wrong thing. Well, because the head of Neffet wasn't a doctor, so you know, how is he going to be held responsible for the medical effects of Neffet's decision? You know, so these guys know about plausible deniability.
I'm sure they do. I'm sure they absolutely do. But that is a good point you raised there. And a lot of the expert testimony will say that you described there is, unfortunately, in Ireland's case, coming from experts outside of Ireland, will say, you know, the names like McCullough, Malone, you know, Robert Cole, there's loads of them, Tess Laurie, all these people. But again, evidence is beneficial to people. Sure. if they were to put it together in Ireland and kind of chase it down themselves, you know, through the route you did.
Yeah, but you see, the other thing then you can bring is your conviction. And that's actually more important than anything, because this affected everybody in different ways. What I value, you know, I don't have children, Jerry. So I wasn't sitting in a house with my three kids, not allowed to go to the park, visit granny. You know, I didn't have that negativity in my life, you know. But somebody else might have, like, somebody else did have that. And it gave them a different set of values about what they lost, the crime that they suffered. So the most important thing is to be convinced of what you're going there to complain about. So it has to be true to you. Make it personal, you know. And then as well, you see, then the idea is it's much easier to get the Garda concerned. You have to provoke curiosity, concern, and it's a lot easier these days because many Garda now know about the vaccine damage. And I think many Garda are suffering from vaccine damage. I've seen some very pasty faces now around courthouses in the last few months, you know. And I'm say that with the most of caring, and I do address it with caring with some people, that some Garda that I know. And I tell them about quercetin, and I tell them about vitamin D and pepper and B complex, niacin, all of these well-tried remedies are so easy to administer yourself. You know, you don't need doctors and all this. But they do have amazing, I have to be careful. Anyway, I'll leave it there.
I know what you mean. No, what I'm noticing is I was at a Freedom Thing group meeting that we meet in Galway every couple of weeks, but I am noticing that there's one or two vaccine injured people starting to come to our meetings, and they've woken up through being injured, if you know what I mean. So I would say it's like anything, when the lower levels of the guards, the average guard, the average nurse, the average, you know, junior doctor, they're trying to do their job. Especially with the guards, I'd say I'd have less. I might take the junior doctors out of that phraseology, but I know privately a lot of guards are not happy with the situation as it stands at the moment. They mightn't be coming out and saying to them that they're not at a point, they're not at a critical mass point where they might start to do something. But I do feel there's certain sectors we're building, the direction is in that direction, as opposed to, you know, people doubling down on some of the malarkey that's been sold to them over the last 3 years. What's your feeling on that kind of?
I think it's kind of, I don't like to say, you know, we seem to be going from cancel culture to self-cancel culture. You know, people are withdrawing, you know, and maybe it's not a bad thing. No, it's not a bad thing personally. I think everybody personally in Ireland needs to undergo cancel culture and get it over with and start building again. You know, but that's different in a profession. You can't expect a judge, a garda, to go, how do they go undergo cancel culture? You know, it's, there won't be a judge or a garda at the end of it, you know? So personally though, I think that's the way we have to go forward, is cancel culture. You know?
Mm-hmm. Well, that brings us on to a very interesting area, because I know, again, I think you were involved or at the hate speech rally in Dublin last weekend. And, you know, you brought up a very good point there. A lot of people are self-censoring themselves. So even if the bar is here, they're censoring themselves here, way below it anyway, because they're afraid of what's gonna might happen in a job, in a club they're in, or whatever, my school.
Anticipated negative outcome.
Yeah. So when you throw in the additional hate speech legislation, I shudder to think what that might look like. But I did raise this. What do you think of the likely outcomes of this legislation going ahead?
I'm concerned. Well, I'm boy. Miss McEntee, Helen Patticlan McEntee, had decided that this was going to be happening before Christmas, but now it seems to be postponed till after Christmas. So that's good. I guess it's kind of scary that it's got to the third phase now, but it got a much stronger reaction, I think, from more people this time. You know, certainly the constitutional crowd seems to have, that argument seems to have stirred people. So I think we're pushing in the right direction on that argument. I think, you know, people are a little concerned. You get two kinds of people on it. It's, well, they're doing that because you're saying this. If you weren't saying that, then they wouldn't have to do this. And then there's the other guy who says, if you don't exercise your rights, you lose them. And the guy who says that you don't exercise your rights, you lose them, he's in a tight spot. He's now going to try and exercise his right, tight spot, and people are going to criticize him. But it's the only thing that I feel. I don't like to criticize anybody's activism or resistance to all of this. I think everybody's got something to add. I don't like the idea of us calling ourselves a movement. We're a proto-movement, if we're anything, if we're even that. I believe there's a huge amount of independence across Ireland, certainly west of Shannon, certainly a large portion of east of Shannon. We know we're strong enough as individuals to beat this. We know, if we pull together as individuals, we will do this. You know? And I have every confidence in ourselves, even more confidence, in fact, in those individuals. Certainly, this is something that has come out of the lockdown scenario, is that many of the people around the country now are comfortable with each other and have broad networks and wide open communication right across the country. And it fortified us and given us a kind of depth. You know, we know each other, we have relationship now in what was a proto-nationalist movement in Ireland.
Mm-hmm. Well, you bring up a very interesting word there, nationalist. Again, it's one of those terms that, you know, people start kind of pointing or applying a label of, you know, far right fascism when they hear Irish people stating a pride in their country or their nation. And I'm just wondering how far this can go, because, you know, you and me grew up in a country that, regardless of what your politics was, 70-80% of it voted either Fine Gael or Fianna Fáil, which were two right parties, really, centre-right parties. And I don't think people buy this baloney about far rights of people, you know, people like you and me. You know what I mean? In a sense, you can call me far right on Twitter, and I've been called it several times, and I was like, well, whatever, like. But it's an interesting, it's this stigmatization of identifying ourselves with our soil and our nation is, how do you feel about that? Or do you agree with what I kind of proposed there on that? That is happening.
Well, I'd actually like to just go back in the conversation and use that word, melogen. It's a total load of melogen. I haven't heard the word melogen there for quite a while, and you held it, so I'm just going to assert that word. It is a complete load of melogen. But then, you know, it's like, you see, now we tend to be painted with the European version of nationalism. First of all, you don't have to be a nationalist to be a national.
Mm-hmm.
You can be a national just by virtue of your birth. You're just born of a nation, the dead generations of this island. And you might have no idea about the philosophy of nationalism or what a nationalist is. You just have the natural rights of your nation, and you wander through your life, and you might never have encountered the philosophy of nationalism. Now, it doesn't mean that you have any less obligations as a national of your nation to protect your nation and future generations and its heritage. But it's done in a much more subtle and natural way. You know, the word nation, the word natural and nature are all the same word. They're natives to be born. It's a natural process. God isn't a supernatural being. He's a natural being. And he gave the nations as a gift to Abraham and his son. And the nations and nationalism we talk about has more to do with that than it does any European version of it. But you wouldn't have to even engage all of that to be a good Irish national. Mm. You know, you don't have to go anywhere near any of that. You know, mm-hmm. You can just love your culture, love your community, conserve your heritage. I think it was Taleb who said we are all communist with our family or socialist with our family and friends. We share. You can use my car and I'll have dinner in your house. No problem. That's how we are. And then at a community level, we're more democratic. We let people live and let live. You know, let my neighbor do what he wants as long as he's not bothering me, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And then when we come to a national or country level, we're conservative. We want to conserve our heritage. We want to conserve our tradition. So it's not that I'm a conservative. That defines me. I have aspects of my personality that I'm actually quite socialist. I'm very caring and sharing when I'm with my family and friends, you know. I'm very democratic in my community. But for my... At this stage in our country's history, when we've been so demoralized and demeaned for no good reason, what did the Irish people do to anybody? You know, the Irish people are not responsible for any of the awfulness I see in the world today. And even if the people of those countries were responsible for what their dead generations done, it's a guilt, it's a self-hatred guilt complex that they've decided to use to silence the nations of the world. And they're doing it individually. They're making different nations ashamed of different things. They're attacking their families and their kids and their traditions. And they're doing it because they believe they have the right to lie to you in order to create the utopia, the globalist utopia that they all try. Well, I disagree. And I think that the world is diverse with its nation. I think that's how, that is the global order, nationalism. Diverse nations that, as our constitution says, in the preamble to the constitution, we earn the respect of the nations. We stand among them and we earn respect. That's nationalism, Irish nationalism.
Mm-hmm.
How can you harm someone, someone's nation, if you go there to earn their respect, to work in their community, to contribute to their society? How could you come and love Ireland? True, the compliment I feel when some of our members come and from other countries and just love Ireland. That's why they're here, you know? And unfortunately, there's a whole set of migrant or refugee that come here to scavenge our resources. They don't come here to add to our culture, to make us feel proud of our culture, to contribute in that way. They come here maybe to scavenge our youth with drug dealing. They come here to scavenge our communities with sex crime. They come here to scavenge our social welfare system. Maybe they come here to scavenge our health system. And these people are not being filtered at our border for nothing less than infantile reasons. Oh, it's racist to check someone's passport. These people got on a plane and destroyed their documents. They didn't do that with good intent. There's nobody destroys their passport with good intent on a plane. So they come off that plane with criminal intent. And they're here to scavenge the resources that our ancestors have provided for our future generation. And it is not to be taken lightly that the standard of living of teenagers in this country has dropped dramatically. It's not to be taken lightly that those people are suffering great psychological trauma in their schools and in their communities. They feel like they're outsiders in their own communities. And this is contributed to by many NGOs and media to demean the local lads and make them. And it's not even lads of a particular color, because I meet fellas of black skin who talk just like they came out of the bog like anyone else. I meet Chinese fellas that talk just like they come out of the bog, you know? You're like, what? It's not about culture, it's not about skin color or any of that. It's about, do you love Ireland? And if you love this Irish nation, if you love your own nation, you're halfway to loving my nation. And if you love my nation, we're allies. Now we're fighting the globalists together. And this is something that has really become apparent in the last few months from other nations. They see that their nation is under attack too, and they're standing shoulder to shoulder.
I think we had a common interest in what was going on in Briefy down near Castlebar, and the situation there, where, you know, there's a mix of different people in it, but there's like 600-700 people down there. And I went along to that meeting. I kind of snuck in late to it. But the most eloquent person I heard speak at it was a Nigerian man who's been living for 25 years in Ireland. And what I took away, he stood up and says, you've got to stop this. And he explained it he explained why in such a way that I've never heard an Irishman kind of say, is that he wouldn't have been able to acclimatize to the Irish culture if there was, you know, 700 or 800 people that came in together at that point. So when they make the argument, and you can see that it's like a talking point that gets handed around to a lot of the left and the media, is when people started using the vetting thing, they started putting out the memes and the tweets about, oh, here I am unvetted at the supermarket, or, you know, why should I, my next door neighbor, I have no say over who my next door neighbor is. Why should you have any say over refugees coming in? And it comes down to being, you know, if 700 people moved in next door to me, I'd have fucking something to say about it. And right. The fact that you would even consider that you don't have a right to have something to say about it, same in East Wall. And the narrative is collapsing, because even the mainstream media, I've seen an outlet today where they've got the tweets that were translated into Albanian by, I think, Minister O'Gorman, where he's out looking for them to come to Ireland on the international refugee front. So they were advertising for people to come to. Now, that's what remained, I'm almost certain it was Gript that did this, but they had the tweets in translated into Albanian to say what the situation.
They were soliciting.
Yeah. So they can't. This is why they're in trouble, I think.
It's an industry, you know.
It's an industry. Like, it's an industry, exactly.
It started in 2008 with property collapse. And now then they were stuck with a bunch of overvalued property on the bank books. They had to keep empty houses out of stock to artificially keep the price up. Now they're looking for tenants. Basically, they need tenants for the overstocked housing before they can put them onto the market. So they're releasing housing. It is that bad. It's simply a corporate equation for housing stock. Our entrepreneurs discovered you can make money from building houses. They were geniuses. I don't know how they ever, it's like, must be like the discovery of the microchip, you know? And ever since then, they're mesmerized with how you put concrete blocks together and put people renting in them. It's some kind of modern technology that you used to generate a good society from, apparently. I don't know what function. But that's what they're doing anyway. And they're bringing in bunches of tenants. And sure, if they're tenants, they might as well be patients in the hospital. And sure, if they're patients, they might as well be students in the colleges. And if they're going to be, you know, it just, and everybody makes more money, you know.
It is definitely, this, you know, it's becoming very clear that the government looked at it, because you can see in the documentation, the money was authorized for the international, and nothing to do with Ukraine, in January of this year, 500 million, at half a billion euros. So that's almost like direct foreign investment into refugees. And the sad thing is, with the Ukrainian stuff and the international stuff, what you're seeing is hotels are saying to themselves, oh God, it's much more profitable for me to run a refugee center than it is to actually have to deal with the public every day. And the worrying thing, worst thing, is the number of nursing homes that have started to close down now. So we're bringing in more people and we're closing down the services available to support those people, and, you know, across everything, health, education, whatever way you want to slice and dice it. So, yeah. Anyway, I went on a bit of a rant there. Apologies. We kind of touched on a subject there, Dara, and it's kind of what I call the kind of woke mob that's developed in this country. And I'd be interested to get your thoughts, because you're one of the, takes a certain character to kind of go on the streets and in, you know, on the front line of the issues on the ground. Because when you do, you meet these characters. And I'd like to get a flavor of how that's been for you personally.
Yeah, I guess that kind of whole scene, it took a nosedive for them maybe 2 years ago. We were kind of in the free speech scene, and then it turned into the lockdown scene. Around that time, all that stuff really fell apart and became very localized. The organization just dissipated, and I guess they began to see sense, because I'm told now a lot of that opposition are not vaccinated. So, that's what I'm told now. Maybe 50% of those guys are not vaccinated. So they were able to, certainly in, we'll say, my area around Galway and that side of the country, a lot of those old adversaries would just be silent allies on that topic. How would that sound? Yeah. But then what developed was a more extreme version of that, at least extreme in ideology now. Their actions were less extreme. They were doing more shouting and noisy things. But their own ideologies were quite a bit more extreme. They were more towards the trans end. You know? It wasn't just that normal stuff that you see all around the world. It was a particular variation of that, but based around trans and such things. And it was quite, you had to be quite delicate there. And you want to be quite, you know, there's a lot of mental disruption going on there, you know. Not everybody, of course, like, you know, the whole, it was just a peculiar change I noticed over the course of the lockdown. But something really interesting happened, and actually I bumped into one of the leaders of the trans end of it, would say, in a very casual setting. I was actually standing at the back of a pub having a cigarette, and he says, oh, he was too, and he said, hey, Dara O'Flaherty, how are you? Now, this should be, these two masses can't occupy the similar space at the same time without annihilating, like, you know, that was, you know, oh, I won't say the guy's name now because I want to be respectful.
No, I don't expect that.
But, so we should have been at each other's throats, but actually neither of us are that kind of people. We would be portrayed that certain, but not really. And we actually spoke for a good hour and a half. And wow. It was formative, I have to say. And now this guy would be nationally known as a activist in that category, we'll say.
Mm-hmm.
It turned out he had a very depraved childhood, and it lasted till quite in his teenager.
Mm-hmm.
And I began to realize that this man actually, he had gone too far in his desire to see, to make sure that what happened to him didn't happen to other kids. He's just gone that just a bit too far. Mm-hmm. He's gone past that. And he was now mm-hmm. saying that if you don't let them cut their penis off, you're damaging them. You know, I could say mm-hmm. So here was this really caring man who had managed to turn his life around after having a horrible child. And he had nothing more to offer than caring. He really hadn't. He was trying to care for these kids as best he could. And my point to him was just eventually, you know, I really don't care about the adults. I don't care what the adults do with transgender.
And I'm with you there. Like, I'm the same place as that.
But when it comes into the school, why is it in primary school? Okay, whatever about secondary school, because I want to talk about the teenagers now. But why is it in primary school? And he could see that I genuinely meant that. As much as I could see, he genuinely meant no harm, that he was actually trying to be caring. Mm-hmm. And he could see that I genuinely meant I was only interested in minding the kids. You know? And he couldn't really argue, and he knew he couldn't, you know. And I've noticed a change. He changed me, and I changed him. And so from that point, then I was given this idea of my communication. So we've had a difficulty getting mainstream or legacy media time to air our side of the arguments. And we tend to kind of hack our way into conversations, or we tend to be, you know, forceful in our conversation when we do get that opportunity. So rather than do that, after experiences that I had with that man and other ones, I like to take the position that I care about these people, that I care, I truly care, not a virtue signal caring. Not that you have to, the caring changes your attitude in the conversation. If you actually care, when you speak to this person, you're going to be looking for some kind of solutions to problems they don't even know they have, or they may not be aware of. You know, and if you go with that attitude that at the end of this conversation, however much this person hates me, I'm going to try and help them. And I'm finding it's given people a kind of a basis that they can say, Dara doesn't take me for a fool, or Dara respects me. That person I'm talking to actually respects me. They're actually trying to get to the bottom of what's bothering. They're listening to me. To care, you have to listen. You really do. And you have to listen attentively, and you have to understand the person. And you can't be trying to stick them into narratives. Well, they're saying that because they're one of these, or they're saying that because they believe this. No, just listen to the person, and they're saying that because that's what they're saying, you know? And they're the author of their life, you know?
Absolutely. I suppose what we lack is places to have the discourse. The lack of a cigarette room in our media, in our alternative media, in fairness as well, in terms of bringing others into the conversation, because I think that resonates with me is true what you just said there, because, and especially like I'm only mostly familiar with kind of people in the West that I meet in the last couple of years. They're all caring people. Like, and they're all pursuing connection with, you know, their spirituality in whatever way that comes, and, you know, bringing themselves closer to authentic living, whether that's with the land or what they're doing with their you know, their work lives and stuff like that. So it's very rare. It's occasional. I won't say it never happens, but it's very rare you meet. I meet someone that you'd say was a lunatic, you know, in the traditional sense of, you know, just spewing narratives. They're very that meeting I was at the other night, it was people, there was a homeopath at it, and the questions, she kept getting questions. I've got a sister, I've got a brother, I want they took the vaccine. They're having this trouble. I want to help them. And even though there might have been conflict in those relationships because of the vaccine, most people I see get over that and they have a genuine concern. It's coming from a concern they made the wrong decision and it's going to hurt them. For the most part, it's not a, oh, I was right, you were wrong, look at me. So I think what we need possibly, and you hit on it there, is nuanced, longer conversations with people who we mightn't agree with.
And you said the right thing there. We're deprived of the smoke rooms to have the conversation. And that's, I think, a product of the way the narratives have been hammered at us over the last number of decades, where our opponent, who is actually the person we're trying to help often, they're in maybe a negative mindset or they're in a emotional, cognitive bias, and you're trying to hack through this or you're trying to get through it. But you'll find that people derail the conversation that you would find solutions in, and they turn it into emotional talk about a particular refugee, for instance. Let's say, let's just go to another narrative altogether. So you're trying to have a conversation, factual and about discrete figures and numbers, and somebody will interrupt with an emotional story about a personal experience of some, and you can no longer have that conversation where you might find solutions. The discrete conversation that talks about resources and availability or logic and reason, these conversations. Instead, somebody feels like they need to interrupt with something caring and emotional. So we need to be careful in our discourse, especially group discourse, that we stay focused on kinds of conversations that can find solutions rather than anecdotal. Like, while they're pleasant and it's group forming and it's social to have those stories, they're not actually, they detract from the strategic conversation, from the logical conversation. So we need to be careful that there are different types of conversation. And I think that's a very important point, that, you know, we have to create the environment. That is the environment that you can have those discussions in. Factual, reason-based, you know.
It's like, I would have grown up, and I'm sure you did too, where there was a lot of, you know, politics was in every, especially in the west of Ireland anyway, politics was in every kitchen table. I always look at my kitchen table as where I learned how to argue or have an opinion, kind of thing, you know, with uncles and cousins and people coming in to, you know, hammer a politician or not, or this kind of thing. And I think what that gave people was an ability to think out of the box in terms of, well, what might the country look like in 10 years' time if we did that or if we did this. And when I have conversations about immigration especially, my fundamental is, well, if we continue down this path, this is what Ireland's going to look like in 20 years. Do you want it to look like that, or do you not? Now, maybe you do. We can have that debate, but to willfully be blind of what the future will be by the behavior our politicians are carrying out at the moment, well, I can't forgive you that sin, because I know you're smart enough to know what you're doing.
I think you said it. That's a good analogy about the kitchen table and politics in Ireland, and, you know, the kitchen courtroom, you know. But the thing that's different, I think, nowadays from those days, I guess I was learning my politics and my argument style at the kitchen table in the 70s and 80s. So in those days, and my neighbors would come in and we'd all have the same, but nobody was beholden to anybody else. Your neighbor could come in and have his dinner and a sandwich, and it wasn't like you were going to pull the plate back off because he was going bored. No one really minded what the other fella beside him meant, and he wasn't obliged to mean that, you know, the family didn't have, you know, we all were roaring and shouting over the same dinner at different pints, you know, there was no beholden to anyone. Whereas nowadays, people have been atomized and fragmented into clearly defined pigeonholes. And if they don't show suitable disgust on their face when that pigeonhole is assaulted by one of the other pigeons, they could be cancelled, you know. So everybody's got, it's balkanized. Everybody's balkanized now. And they're beholden in their conversations, the Balkan that they're aligned with. So how do you have honest debate? How do you broaden? It goes back to the those cigarette rooms you were speaking about. You know, we have to create little oases where people can be free to push the boundaries of the debate without getting their head chopped off. You know.
Well, obviously, if you're going to explore your thoughts, a lot of your thought exploration is going to go down the wrong direction. That doesn't mean when you do it, you say, oh, that's a load of bollocks, come back from that. But you can't, that's how you make progress. Like, that's how you kind of figure out what's right and wrong. And you brought up a point there about that kind of kitchen table debate is, nobody was afraid to, I don't mean nobody, but I mean, most people weren't afraid of expressing their opinion, even if they knew that it was going to be opposite to yours. Like, I know in our family, it was almost a case where if you wanted to confuse people in our family, you just started agreeing with them because they wouldn't, you know, it was kind of, they wouldn't know what to do with that. Like.
Yeah. What's this fellow want now? He's rubbing me up like. Yeah. There was always a politics behind the politics.
Yeah. So I agree with you because that's, and having those conversations and trying to do those, and create those spaces is something I'm very interested in. In a selfish sense, is like I want to have these conversations with people, you know. But also having a forum. I don't know. Have you any ideas of how that could work, or how people might go about doing that?
Well, you know, it was traditionally the pubs, wasn't it? And it was traditionally kind of out and about. And it's like I tend to spend of every day a couple hours around the town, and I meet people that, you know, want to talk to me about this topic or that topic. I make myself available to people to have physical conversations, much more so than I do. I'm much more available in person than I am on the phone. I just detest the phone.
That's a good policy.
it doesn't mean I have the privilege of not using it. I still have to engage, even though I don't like it. But I guess it's got its uses, of course. But I tend to concentrate on the physical interaction and increasing my value in the network of physical reactions now that I have today. So I have physical reactions now throughout my day, and they all add up to a day's physical interaction. And I have a wealth more to look forward to as the week goes on, rather than, oh, I have to contact this fella on WhatsApp, that fella on Telegram, this fella over here. It's all on the internet. My life is actually mostly in the real world. You know, I'm interacting physical things all the time. And I find it much more rewarding. I find it's much more fraught. It's not as easy or comfortable, but the reward is completely different. And you find that the people you're interacting with, it's very easy to become convinced that everybody's snappy and snarky on the internet. That's not how people are in reality. You know, when you're out walking around, people are only delighted when you say hello to them, even as a stranger, you know. You know, I do say, you know, you'd see something silly happening and you'd make a comment and start laughing. You know? It's like, you know, a lot of people like that, you know. It's great. Don't be afraid. You know?
No, it's a very small cohort of people that are. It's just, I suppose, social media's given such amplification to a very particular slice of the social narrative that we. And by the way, I think the most people affected by it are our political class, because they genuinely think that this is how to a degree. That might seem like I'm letting them off the hook, but no. I got the sense in the pandemic one of the kind of warning signals for me early was when I saw the likes of Simon Harris and they're doing TikTok videos and that's how they're communicating with the people. And I'm thinking, Jesus, this is totally fucking different now. And
yeah.
And their reaction to that is Yeah, but the reaction to that is only coming from a very particular slice of the internet. Do you know what I mean? Most people like you, and even when Musk revealed the daily Twitter users, it's a lot less than everybody had thought it was. You're talking about a couple of hundred million, but you think in you know 8-9 billion people in the world, you're just thinking, and the people within that are making the noise, you're talking about a very tiny slice of people. So I think they're probably the most captured of all of us, is that kind of political journalistic class, because they're, especially the journalists, are kind of rewarded for it.
Yeah, no, according to some of my, we'll say, research-focused colleagues, echo chamber, a reassuring echo chamber that every Irish politician built up on Twitter and Facebook, changed 6 or 8 months ago and became a reverberating anger chamber. And apparently there are very, very few politicians now, when they look at their feeds, okay, see anything other than vitriol and anger about their handling of, and they're not able for it. Apparently, they don't know how to handle it. They're banning people, and you know, things are. They're panicking, basically. You know, no, I'm not in tune with all this. I'm just going off.
That rings true. I hadn't thought of that actually, but it does take. It does take a certain certainty about yourself to not be affected by, you know, at the end of the day, some anonymous person, even if they're a known person, they've never met you. You don't know. They don't know what you're like in your day-to-day life. And if you're, you know, I suppose a lot of politicians probably are fragile. You know, it's a fragile enough business, but it's also, a lot of them have fragile, while they might have big egos, some of them, they might have fragile egos to criticism, definitely. But I hadn't thought of that.
If they went to that, and I understand exactly, you're precisely correct, that is exactly what's happening. People who are used to having themselves reinforced are now learning, maybe you're not getting reinforced. How do you deal with that negative criticism? Well, how about you go and you look at that criticism with a truly caring attitude? What difference would that make if a politician looked at his criticism and he really cared about it? Not he cared about how it made him feel bad, but how he cared about how he could fix the thing that the person was criticizing. If he really cared what that person said awful about him, and instead of focusing on that awful part, focus on the solution that that person, so now you're caring about the person who's criticizing. How do I make things better so that that person can't make that criticism? And now it's not so hard to deal with the criticism anymore. You know, so if our politicians conduct themselves with the caring that we were talking about a half an hour ago or 10 minutes ago, they wouldn't have the criticism in the first place, but they'd be better able to deal with it. So,
but you know, I suppose that you raised the question of how many in our political class are that type of individual, or how hard is it to get that stuff out of a certain portion of them? Like you see, what I do get in a bit of hope from is you see the likes. I was very glad to see Matty McGrath and Senator Keown and a few others have a public meeting on the hate speech legislation in a hotel and invite the public in with no preconditions or any of that. Like, I think we need a plethora more of that stuff, like, to be going
absolutely
on all things. Now, I would say one of the benefits of probably discrimination and all of that last year is that we now have probably 50 or 60,000 people in the country who are watching every single piece of legislation that's going through the Dáil in detail, probably too much. But at the same time, I can't ever remember, you know, pre-COVID maybe, well, definitely pre-2008, I couldn't tell you what legislation went through the Dáil for the 15 years before that. Do you know what I mean? So it's
That's watching
her, I can tell you. Yeah, well, I like this is a, this is an area I wanted to get into now, because I suppose and it's, you know, a lot of us have come together, we've just got to know each other through the pandemic. Where was Dara O'Flaherty pre-pandemic, or what kind of, I know you've, you know, activism and stuff like that has played a large role in your life. Who was Dara O'Flaherty before the pandemic?
Well, immediately prior to the pandemic,
was he the same guy? Or, you know, what kind of interests were you pursuing before that?
Well, I think we alluded to, was it last Christmas, how bad things had gotten, that they were talking about excluding us and such. And that was a pivot point for me. For the person I was before the lockdown, who was great at anticipating future outcomes 2, 3, potentially 5 years in the future based on the data. I'm an industrial engineer. You know, I'm supposed to be able to make predictions using statistics. So I had built up quite a worldview of even in the future, up to lockdown and COVID and all that. And really, the first year of it all, it was very, very unsettling for me because I had no view of the future. I did not know what the future looked like. It turned out all the data I had was false. And all this new data, I didn't even know the jargon that it was coming. You know, I had no worldview. I didn't, it was a paradigm shift. Who knows where it was going to end up, you know? But last Christmas, it really came to a head for me where I genuinely believed they were going to be coming up the driveway with a syringe to stick in my arm. We had them talking about it in the Dáil. They were at the stage now there with the hate speech legislation. That's where they were with mandatory vaccination this time last Christmas. So I took that Christmas to turn the computer off and know that when I turn the computer back on, it's going to be booting up on different software. It's going to be booting up on different data. And it took a few days of self-reflection and such. And I did do that. And it took a month or two then after that to kind of rebuild a worldview now, you know, that it's going to be cogent and coherent going forward. So, yeah, certainly Dara has changed pre-lockdown, post-lockdown. And I remember when it happened, you know. I remember the week it took that self-reflection period. You know? So I guess I was...
What direction did you think the world was going in pre-COVID? Probably, was it a case that COVID accelerated all the things that you thought might take 10 years or 15 years? Or was it a complete different... Was it the complete kind of paradigm shift, as you said there?
Well, you know, I met someone recently who had one of my election flyers, which was pre-COVID. Oh. And I said, give me that now a second. I just want to change something for you. And I updated it. I crossed out, was it 35%? And I wrote in 48%. And that was the only thing that was different. There you go. Now it's updated. So I was talking about the migration rates. You know, the level of people who were not born in Ireland, the percentage of our population was not born in Ireland. And I had claimed at the election time it was somewhere between 27 and 32%, which was pretty accurate. And now the updated would be 48%, I'd say. 48% of the people in this country are not from Ireland. So that's the only thing that changed politically for me. Everything else is identical. I was on the free speech. I was on seaweed. I was on all kinds of Western and national issues. You know, immigration, LGBT, transgenderism, the health budget is just ridiculous. So we don't have a health system. We have a meat grinder. We're some ridiculous proportion of the Irish health budget is actually spent on litigation between the HSE and the various subcontractors it uses to administer the hospital. It's something, some years it's up to 70% of the budget of the HSE is spent on litigation between the various parties in the HSE. So, you know, so industrial engineers tend to go to root branch analysis very quickly. And, you know, it's when you look at some statistics are far more telling than others, and they speak to intent. You know, some statistics speak, like they say, lies, damn lies, and statistics. Statistics have an uncanny way of revealing the truth as well, I can tell you.
And is the political arena something that you're still interested in now, Dara, or has the pandemic shifted your mind in that? Like, would you consider running in, are you considering running in, you know, whether it's local or general elections or that kind of thing? Or what's your thought process on that?
Yeah, I think that a candidate of my nature, my base nature, in that I am doggedly determined to get to the bottom of whatever it is that is between my teeth. And I will not be dissuaded by the common pressures of court cases and spurious charges in the paper. This is something many current sitting TDs have been through, you know, where they use spurious charges and the inferences that can be made in order to keep them from running. I'm quite confident that the people who have been living under the boot of An Garda Síochána, the Irish state, the Irish media, I think there's a huge proportion of our electorate who are aware of how the system protects itself in Ireland and just how much people have to deal with when they attack the system. So I don't wear my convictions as convictions. I wear them as the stripes that qualify military officers. Each one is a stripe that makes me a sergeant or whatever it is. And I won't be changing. And yes, I do intend to continue to pursue political ambitions in Galway and further afield, because there's no one who can do what I do. And there's no one who can do determination I do. And I believe that needs to be done. That's what needs to be done, is that we need to approach these problems with the honesty and the integrity that we saw in the old style Republicans of Ireland. Everybody gets a chance to speak. You make your case, tell the truth. If we know when you're telling the truth and when you're not, and we'll make a decision after that. And that's the way these things need to be done. Rationality, unemotionalism. Leave emotionalism at the door. It's what's clouded everybody's judgment. And to be honest, I don't trust anyone to do the job like it needs to be done other than myself.
No, it's good. We need like people. And just one thing you brought up there, and it's one thing I think, you know, some of the parties that have emerged over the last number of years that are trying to put their heads. But I always think that nobody, and I think it's a worthwhile exercise, and in terms of the industrial engineer's mind of yours as well, is, you know, the concept of voter registration drives is not one that's ever been taken up in Ireland, really, by, you know, it's a very much kind of an American thing. But I think it would scare the absolute bejesus out of the government if you factor in up to maybe 45% of the people don't participate in the electoral process. That if you took, we'll say, in a place in Galway, we probably both know, Dúishka, that would probably have a high percentage of big population, probably a mix of the generational Polish, Irish working class, not just working class, but very much open-minded to voting in like independents and different types of characters. But like I think a voter registration drive, if somebody was to do it, as a statement of a kind of campaign that would announce themselves to an area well in advance of an election, so that, you know, that name recognition is built up door to door, you know, it's built up door to door for somebody. But that's just a by the by.
No, I think that's excellent. I really like that idea. Certainly I have great difficulty with the show people, the number of people who show up to the election. I think we might have been a bit caught the last general election. There was a storm, at least in Galway and the West Coast. I think that did affect those underdog voters because, you know, they didn't feel represented anyway. Why would they bother going out in the rain to vote? You know, if it was a nice day, they might have took trouble to go down and vote for their local underdog. But, you know, when it's lashing rain, you got, you know, the underdog is wet too. You know? So I think we, now hopefully that will give us a certain stealing going into the next election. You know? But absolutely, yeah. I really like that idea. And the idea of the community, getting people, they hear the negative of that story all the time, that narrative all the time. And to go around to people and just say, look, you know, your country needs you. Your country needs you to be aware. Yeah. All too often we hear the, well, I don't, I'm not interested in that kind of thing. You know, that that's a very dangerous attitude these days.
Well, my attitude is, and I guess, and I know there's a cohort, we'll say, of the people we probably, you and I meet, who you want to deregister completely from the system. And I'll probably have a few of them characters on the channel just to find out what they're talking about. But if you look at the electoral process, I think there's still, if that's how you feel, nobody represents me, fine, go into your polling box, put a big X or a Z or whatever you want to put through your polling vote and register your discontent. That would be my thing on it. Do you know?
I got a better deal for those guys. Deregister that. And I can understand your position, and I've discussed it with many of you guys over the years. And obviously, I think a different way. So how about this? How about you deregister for 4 years and 6 months? And then when you know that an election is about to happen, you register for the duration of the election. Go and vote. Only vote for the number of candidates that can get seats. If you vote past, if you're a five-seat constituent, vote up to five. Don't vote six because you've just voted against the guy you picked for number one. So go out and pick five candidates or pick one candidate. So there's got to be somebody on that list that somehow aligns with most of what you think or a lot of what you think. And that is a better scenario than not voting at all. It's better voting for a fella who thinks 30 to 40% of what you think than not voting at all. And we're in a scenario where it has never meant more. We have no other, like back in the day, you know, we had a lot more opportunities for standing up to authority and power. We saw what happened to those that stood up in Canada. And so I would imagine that that's how it's going to be for us in the future. So we've got very little time left to use this democratic system that they rant about all the time. And I would encourage people to give it a lash, you know.
Well, even that's if what I would agree with you, Dara, like on that, because, and I think what a lot of people run past is, you know, if you take it on the basis that nothing brings the government down, on that assumption, just for, it might be tenuous. The next election is the local elections. The local elections came six, seven months before the last general election, so that the locals are due before the next general. And what I would say to people that have notions of, you know, especially first-time candidates that have never done it before, go out into a local election area. It takes less than 1,000 votes to get elected in a lot of constituency, and it's a maths problem. It's not like to get elected as a county councillor. That's just a mathematical. You put it in, you'll get it out. Analysis, because the votes, you'll find 800 or 900 people, and it's not even 1,000. Like the last, it's not even that number. It's just, but it's a case of how bad do you want it? You have to go out, and this is, I suppose, the modern era of elections has nearly gone online. Your interaction with all these characters is through advertising online and all this time. You cannot beat the personal touch. Now, not everybody, you have it, but you cannot beat the personal connection. It's, you know, that's...
And, you know, to run for election with the idea of getting elected, okay, that's a great idea. It's very conducive to a positive attitude while you're running an election. The likelihood is the first time you run, the second time you run, you're not going to get elected. You can't very well walk around thinking that. You know, you won't do anything.
It won't do you any good,
you know. So there's other objectives. You get to put your narrative through the front door of someone's house with a piece of paper. The government are going to deliver this piece of paper that you give. to everybody in your constituency in the general election. You get an opportunity to go around and knock on people's door and convince people, and you meet people that you know, but you didn't know where they lived, and now you know where they live, and they say, come in and have a cup of tea, and now I'll hand them, I'll come with you, and I'll help you hand out the flyer. I know Tom, I know, you know, and you get all this massive network, physical network interaction that's so rewarding, you know. Next thing, you're on the radio, you're in a debate, you're at a debate in a school with other politicians, and you're introducing new narratives and different perspectives on the same narratives. So there's many, many objectives that you can achieve just by paying your €500 and registering for the election. You know, if we could get 10 candidates, we could flood the whole narrative across the nation. And they're there. There's 10 people like me in every county in Ireland.
Oh, absolutely.
They're doing rents as well as me, give out as well as me. Like, you know, we've no excuse. What will it take in Galway? It costs me something like €1,200 to deliver a flyer to 64,000 residents. So, you know, you have no excuse. You know, those.
So I suppose, Dara, I'll just ask you again, we've had a couple of technical difficulties here. If you can tell us what the future holds for yourself and anything, you know, anything you want to promote or any kind of stuff that you have coming up.
Yeah, well, you know, I really just show up to events. You know, people all around me ask me to come to their events, and I'm happy to oblige. I really enjoy it. But mostly, I'm concerned most of my stuff goes on behind the scenes, you know. I guess some people know me from making videos, and I really enjoy making those, but most people wouldn't believe how much goes into making a video. So I like that, and I like that community educator side of it, and I really would prefer to be concentrating on that rather than activism. And I'm activism gets me into trouble, in case you haven't noticed. And so I think I've demonstrated to everybody how to look after themselves when they're out and about now, and yeah. I'm so happy to see true grassroots things happening all over Ireland. It's it's a big relief, you know.
Yeah,
it means this past couple of years have really been worthwhile.
Mm-hmm. Because one of the I suppose before I let you go is one of the things you mentioned to me is you kind of described yourself as kind of, no, I don't know, I don't want to say homeless, but kind of a person that has rejected you had a quite good life, and you were kind of one end of the spectrum in terms of maybe the material stuff at one point. You obviously took a decision to you know, cast that aside.
Indeed, yeah. I spent a period of my life making quite a lot of money. Now, I don't have any of that money left, but it didn't bring me anything, any kind of thing I would refer to as happiness.
Mm-hmm.
It didn't give me, money didn't bring me happiness. It brought me a bunch of bad habits. I was very, very much overweight. I was very, very unhealthy. And, you know, eventually I decided that Ireland was where I needed to be. And I gave up that lifestyle. Affluent lifestyle, and I discovered something else, and it's a much calmer place for my head. It's a much more peaceful place of existence. Whatever, I may not have that affluent lifestyle, but I can wake up in the same position I went to sleep in. These things are very important to me now, and I think going forward, for anybody, I don't ever see myself going back to that kind of lifestyle. I can tell you it just wasn't worth it, you know. If I have enough to feed myself and keep myself warm and dry, I'm very happy. And I am technically a homeless person in that I don't have a home myself, but so many of my community welcome me to their own homes, and it's a real privilege, and it has kept me very active throughout all of this tyranny that we've been living under for the last couple of years, and it forced me into the mix, you know. I wouldn't trade it for the world, to be honest. It's an amazing experience.
That's good. I don't mean it's, I think we all share that an increasing number of people that I meet now, that idea of bringing things much closer back to the ground in terms of not getting distracted by things that just consume you in the cycle of materialism and consumerism. And I feel what you're saying there. Like, I think, you know, that is, we need a lot more of that. Because again, one of the things there is the plus side of it is it brings you into, you meet more people than probably most people meet in an average week. Do you know what I mean? In a real physical sense.
Well, what it is I find is that I get to spend quality time with friends and colleagues, you know. I have dinner, I have meals with these people, you know. So it's not, hey, how are you at this event? I haven't seen you in ages. It's, hey, how are you? I'm going to be living in your house this week, you know. You know, so it goes, yeah. And I get to meet the community then that's around that person and, you know, how mm-hmm. they support themselves. And, mm-hmm. and you know, it's great. I don't mean to say, like, you know, it's, you know, I have a great time or anything like that. It's not like that, you know. It's but the challenge is, anything worthwhile is a challenge, right? So
absolutely,
this is really worthwhile.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. Now, I just want to finally say thank you for this.
Well, the solutions to my problems would be, if I can fix my problems, I can fix everybody's problems, you know. So if you fix my problems, we'd be great. Yeah. You know, that's kind of the way I look at it. Get it down to the brass tacks. It's diet.
Well, I have to say, what I do diet have to say is that enormous. In the end of year awards, yourself, Andy Heisman, and Dave O'Reilly have to be the most stylishly dressed activists on the scene.
That's not a phrase I expected to hear this evening, I have to say. That's not a phrase I expected to hear this evening. Stylish, referring to myself, you know, I'm generally a hairy, fluffy, raggedy looking chap, you know. But, you know, look, there's a certain...
you present yourself very well.
We're talking about very, very well. Mm-hmm. It's not through any particular taste I have. No, the other lads particularly might be more tasty than myself, but I take a lot of coordination from other people in order to present myself in a way that is palatable to the masses, you know?
Yeah, but not being kind of flippant about it, it is when I watched those videos between yourself and Andy Heisman, it does make a difference to the authoritarian people you're going into. You're not going in there with a tracksuit hanging around your arse, like, do you know what I mean? In terms of the visual of you, when I see people like that, I'd say, oh, these, I'm dealing with serious people here, like, do you know?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, and it's a certain level of formality, you see, when you go to a place with a jacket and a suit on. You know, you're saying that I'm not having a casual conversation. I'm having a formal conversation, you know. And, you know, we can use our wardrobes and our demeanor to convey that, you know, that this isn't a friendly chat. That I'm not shooting the breeze. I'm having a very serious conversation about legal matters, you know, that are very concerning to me. To the point where I've dressed myself up because I value... what you think of me in this situation. I want to make the best of the situation. I take it so seriously.
Absolutely. And it's a respect for the institutions of the you're dealing with, whether some of the people in there deserve that respect. Someone might argue, you know, here or there, but I always think it conveys a respect to the institution that, you know, you're taking it, you know, you're taking it seriously and you have a, you know, a deep regard for it.
Yeah, the human aspect of it is very important. You know, you're dealing with humans in the end, you know, and humans want to feel respected. And when you take the trouble to dress yourself in that way, it's easy for them to feel respected. So, you know, why would you not do that and make your mission easier, you know?
Mm-hmm. Sorry, I didn't mean to drag you down into the style council there, but I thought it was it's a thing that's it's often remarked. Dara, I just want to take the opportunity to thank you very much for. Hopefully, we'll meet very shortly. We're in Galway. I'm in Galway. You're in Galway. But I just want to take the opportunity to thank you for this conversation. I've got a lot out of it, personally speaking. Hopefully, everybody that watches it will get as much out of it as I have. And I just want to wish you the best of luck in upcoming things going on in your life. And just again, to anyone that's watching, Dara is on Telegram, does have a Telegram channel. It's easy to find, Dara O'Flaherty. And I just going to say we'll leave it at that, unless you have anything else you'd like to add for the end.
No, thank you, Jerry, for the opportunity to talk to your audience. And I really respect the integrity do your work with, and you hold a position that's consistent, you know, and it's very important. It's missing. It's so sorely missing nowadays.
Well, thanks for that. I appreciate that. I'll take us offline now, and we'll end the recording.